Hey, hey, everybody. Welcome on into the special Valentine's Day kiln opening. Ooh, we got a lot of Valentine's Day pieces in here. Some we glazed together in this last week's Clay Share Live. If you missed that, you can check out the replay. Premium members, we glazed 4 peacock pieces, those peacock glazing technique pieces. They're in this kiln too, and I'm going to show them to you. So we're going to do all that together right now. Are you ready? Kiln fired, cone 5, medium speed with an hour and a half preheat at the beginning, and I think I did a 17 minute hold at the end. Took a total of 13 hours and 7 minutes to fire, and it is currently at, you want to hear the temperature? So everybody always asks, what temperature should I unload your kiln? Can you see my breath? The kiln is at 48 degrees. So 48 degrees is completely fine for unloading your kiln. A 48 degree kiln, open that up and unload it, baby, because they're cool enough, I promise. No doubt about that. All right, let's do it. And it's probably gonna be a fastish one. I will share all the combos of glazes and everything, but it's very cold and, you know, goodness, where to start? We got to start with the cone pack right here. Hello, hello, hello. I look cold. I'm not cold yet. I'm still warm. We'll see how it goes. Here's my cone pack. Cone 4, cone 5, cone 6. Lovely melt for cone 5. 6, just softening a little. That's fine. This is a good cone 5 firing. Happy with this. So this was the top. I got another one in 4 at the bottom. So we can compare the two, but I do know that the kiln got to cone 5, which it got good glaze melt. So you want to ogle the copper glaze. There's copper glazes in here. All right, so we'll just start off with this hanging planter, our hanging planter class. This I glazed in my nutmeg glaze, which is coming out the end of the month. And what's really great about this is I brushed this on. It's the dip and pour version, but I brushed it on. I can't get in too close. I don't have my lights set up so that I have good lighting on it. It would blind it. Here, maybe I can get it over there. You can see. But anyhow, this, I used a silicone fondant mat to get that texture in there. You just press that into your clay and you get really cool wood. And I thought the glaze plays nicely with that wood technique. Well, the wood look. The faux wood look for my unkillable plants. So this will hang on the wall. Here's the holes. I'll put a little cord through here and I'll hang it and it'll keep my plants in it. And they'll probably be plants we can't kill because, you know, I kill plants. So this was a piece that I've done similar glaze combos before. And we got some beautiful wave texture going on the inside. I used Speedball Black underglaze that I applied first. So that really brings out the texture. See if I can get that in close enough for you to see with the lighting as is. Let me pull this here. Taking this light. So we're currently in my temporary space for my kilns. There we go. Now you can see a little better. We're in my garage. That's where the kilns live right now. They're only going to be here probably another 6-7 months because we're building a new studio this summer. And the kilns will move over there. But until then, and the rest of the studio, this is where we are. So it's got its own charm. It's a garage. It's great. So black Speedball underglaze first, wiped back, then Laguna Peacock. And I used the Laguna Peacock glaze, the 95, which is the one that is made for vertical forms. But you can put it on horizontal forms. And the reason they differentiate is they have another peacock that Laguna makes that runs like crazy. So this is the 95. And then after I did 2 good coats of that, on the very rim, I did a 1-inch wide band of Celadon Bloom from Mako, 2 coats of that. And then on top of that, I did Mako's Light Flux on the handles. So I got some meltalicious stuff happening there. And it's really very pretty. A lot going on. And when we talk about layering glazes, I know there's a lot of concern about food safety, as there should be, especially with a bowl that we're going to have food in. But you'll notice I did all of my layering up here on the rim. We're not going to be eating food off of the rim here. If you're serving food, I doubt you're going to fill it up to there. If you are, you're going to be sloshing food all over. So that would be a bad thing for cleaning, like your house, because you're making a mess. But we're just going to fill it up to here and it's fine. So, whoa! Oh, there's the back. Moving the light helped. Yeah, we had to bring the lights down. They usually live upstairs. These are all the filming studio lights, and there's no lighting down in the garage. Oh, which way do we go? Okay. So this is another one of my little cardinal mugs. And the inside is my black copper. So I poured that on the inside. Just a thin layer, nothing really thick. But I thought the copper would be a nice contrast to the colors I used on the outside, which are Georgie's Interactive Pigments in Autumn Foliage, wiped back. So you brush that on and then you wipe it back. And then I put Eggshell Wash glaze from Georgie's on as well. And it's on the bottom. When it's wiped back, it will not stick to your kiln shelves, which is a beautiful thing. So this one, and then I did another one, basically the exact same, except the inside of this one's in Chun Plum. And this is in the black copper. So just two different color options, depending on what you want. I really want to play off the red for the little cardinal, but I didn't want bright red. So it's a big kiln. Someone said, oh, no, she's so tiny. It looks huge. I also have the kiln raised up on pavers. So it's not flat on the ground. It's raised up about 3 inches. So it seems significantly taller than it would normally see. Yeah. But I am little. It's true. I've got another mug in there. So this one was testing out. I wanted to go with something more antiqued look. So I used Mako's copper wash. I applied that to the surface first. And then I wiped it back so that it filled in the recessed areas with a lot of copper, and I only did that on the outside. And then on top of that, I used green tea, which is another great glaze from Mako, and that's what's on the inside. And then I thought it would be fun to see what happens when you put dark flux on top of the green tea, and that's what we have on the inside of the rim. It's just dark flux, two coats over the green tea, two coats of the green tea all over. Inside and out. So how many coats did I brush on with the nutmeg? One, because it's a dip and pour glaze, not the brushable version. So let me go back to that and we'll clarify that for those who are asking. The nutmeg that I have, the version I have, is the dip and pour version, not the brushable version. Normally when you brush on a glaze, you have to put a couple coats on, but this is the dip and pour version. So I just dipped a really wide fan brush, a number 8 Mako fan brush, in the nutmeg glaze after I stirred it up. And then I just brushed it all on, swatch, swash, 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 all over, the whole thing. And that's it, one coat. And it's a little thinner. And I can't remember if I have another piece with the nutmeg in it later on. When it's thicker on B-Mix, when the nutmeg is thick, do you see how we have, let me see if I find a spot. See how we have this yellowish, beautiful, buttery yellow? See the yellow on the, there it is on the edge right there. When it's thick, it goes more yellow. When it's thinner, you get more orangey, warmer tones. This is on B-Mix, but on darker clays, it goes even warmer and toastier. So I personally like it better on darker clay. It has more of a reduction fired look to it. But what I love about this is it's a great way to show it on a light clay. You get a brighter color and you see, do you see texture? that's silly, right? Of course. So the nutmeg, you can see the texture. So it worked out really well. So yes for texture, and yes for brushing on a dip and pour glaze. All right, have a couple of the peacock pieces that we did. You think the lighting is too much now? You know what I can do? I can, we're very limited in our options currently. You love the Georgie's Interactive glazes and the copper on the inside. It's really beautiful, isn't it? So the black copper's gorgeous. It is food safe, yes. And these were fired to cone 5. The black copper is a glaze I've been using for 20 years. It's my glaze. I developed it 20 years ago. Been using it all this time. It is food safe. It has nothing in it that can be an issue at all for food safety. So this is a bowl you might have seen similarly. I did this as a make-along during Clay Share Primetime this past week, so you could check that out if you missed it. But and all the colors that I used, I mentioned in that, because I forgot to write them down. I didn't write them down. I'll have to go rewatch it. But I believe I used Blue Isle and Caribbean Blue for my dots, Light Flux, and then the glaze itself is Celadon Bloom. So that's the actual glaze that I put on the entire piece. You like the nutmeg. It's a very versatile glaze, and I haven't done a lot of layering with the nutmeg glaze yet, but I will. But let me just... the inside. Look at the inside. This is an ice cream bowl for me. Like, I'd eat ice cream out of this. I'd eat oatmeal out of this. I'd probably eat anything out of this. This is good. This is good. All right, another peacock piece. We did a cup because we were talking about, can you do cups? Will it melt too much? And we did it on the outside of the cup. And if you look, wow, how pretty is that? So I believe you guys will have to help me. I used Jaded and Teal Next Time, and then Blue Hydrangea from Mako outside. And then Light Flux, same thing on the inside too. Oh yeah, oh my goodness. And then Light Flux. And look, we had nearly, but no oopses. It didn't melt too far down. So it's not my daughter's chip bowl, Libby. It's the one we glazed just like her chip bowl. The chip bowl is altered. So you're thinking, so this is just a perfect circle. The one I made for my daughter is one that we altered, and when after I threw it, I made it into a, I believe it's six-sided bowl, but this is one we glazed just like her bowl because I was making the bowl. I knew she was going to want it, so I gave it to her for Christmas. Anyhow, cute, right? Good examples of the peacock layering technique. All right, let's start pulling out shells, and we got one more thing on the top. We'll get to that in just a second. Did not expect what I'm seeing here. All right, I have got the fairy house we glazed many moons ago in the live broadcast. Here it is. The mushrooms we used. Oh goodness, I have to go back and think. Chun plum. We used iron oxide wash, and then chun plum on top of that. We used Shino oolong gloss on the top. We used iron oxide wash on the handle here. We used stroke and coats in many colors. We used the stroke and coat camelback brown. We used their hot tamale red, their just froggy green, their orange in the windows, and lots of pretty stuff happening. Now, I fired it with the lid on. So sometimes you gotta work it a little bit to get the lid off. And my plan is to take it in the house, do a few tap, tap, taps with a wooden spoon, and that usually pops the lid off. But it is a lidded piece. So, although, sculpture if it doesn't come off. So, it works. We'll see if it comes off. I don't know. It should come off. I'm not really worried. I made sure that when I glazed it, I had no glaze where the lid touched. Ooh. All right, so I did another one of those hanging planters, and this one I used Amoco Celadon glazes, and I did an ombre glazing. You notice how we're lighter here and darker down here? Same thing on the side, lighter to darker. I used Amoco's Tangelo two coats on the whole thing, and then Amoco Poppy two coats down here, and up the sides, going up the sides, I would say about halfway. Yeah. And so that gives a nice ombre effect. And then a little light flux right in here. I just wanted to see what would happen. Little something, but this will hang on the wall. You really won't see much back here. You'll just see this part, and then your plants will hang down. I do love the fairy house. Yes, Jen, I love the fairy house. And then I made a fairy house mug for my mug person, which I just got a pack and ship. I haven't shared any images except a quick little video unloading a kiln a week or so ago, I think. I think it was about a week ago I shared that. My temporary kiln post storage is just the ledge back there. Oh, we have one more piece. Okay. This is a surprise. The colors are such a surprise on this because they are speedball black underglaze applied, wiped back. So I thin the underglaze down and I apply it all over and then I wipe it back, let it dry, and then two coats of Georgie's eggshell wash. That's the glaze. So it's a satiny finish. All of this so far is food safe. No worries. We can eat off this little plate. And then the red cardinals are just a little bit of speedball red underglaze brushed on top of the glaze. And the cool thing is speedball black underglaze goes blue when you put eggshell wash on it. I mean, look at that. That's not what I thought it was going to do. I must have done this combo at some point in my life other than this, but I didn't document it, obviously. But it looks like a chilly winter day with little birdies. So I'm happy with that. And what I really love about it is when we use pigments, interactive pigments, they're not food safe. But speedballs underglaze, 100% food safe. So no worries. If I'd used a clear glaze, it would have been black, not blue. The eggshell wash made it blue. So, yeah, so this shape, I think we made this together in a live broadcast. We did Valentine plates together. I used the heart shape from GR Pottery Forms and Debbie Dela Cruz's De La Designs triangle cutter to make this really fun, not so traditional heart plate. Yeah, cute, right? So, and it's fun seeing it turn out, you know, a little differently than I expected. I thought it was gonna be a black and white piece with the red birds, but it wasn't. Right? That's just like the magic of the kiln. So, it tells me a couple things. It tells me that Speedball's black has cobalt in it, or it has, well, it doesn't have cobalt in it, it has mason stains. It has a mason stain in it that goes blue, which is just really interesting, but it goes blue when it's paired with the eggshell wash, not necessarily other glazes. More pots to see. Okay, just a simple heart plate. Just from a placemat, I pressed the placemat into the clay to get the texture, pulled it out, used the GR Pottery form, heart, cut the shape out, and then draped it over the same form. Have I used speedball underglaze for paneling type things? Absolutely, all the time, no problems with finish. I do a lot of painterly underglaze with it. I do a lot of watercolor underglaze, watercolor pottery with speedball. I've been using speedball longer than any other underglaze product. I don't know how long. 8 years? 9 years? I don't even know anymore. I can't remember stuff. You do it so long, you forget, right? So that came out great. Oh, do you want to know what glaze? Do you want to know what this is? What? So far, all the clay has been Laguna B Mix 5. And this is 5 as well. The glaze on this is Poppy Celadon from Amoco, and then a little bit of light flux on the rim. Just a bit to give it some movement. One coat of light flux, two coats of poppy. So Speedball Black goes blue with another clear glaze. You're not sure which one. You know what I think it has to do, Michelle? I think it's zinc. I think zinc or not zinc will affect it. I think zinc-free should go black, but with zinc, I think it'll go blue. I have test tiles with all of them upstairs. Just can't grab them right now or else I'd share with you. And then I thought we got a bunch of light flux happening. Let's do some dark flux. People are always asking about dark flux. This is Weeping Plum and Mulberry. So two coats of Weeping Plum to the whole thing. One coat of Mulberry to the inside on the rim and just right into here. You can see where the color change happens. So maybe that's a 3/4 inch wide. And then dark flux on the Mulberry right up here. So it's Weeping Plum Celadon from Amoco. It is Mulberry Celadon from Amoco. Two coats of the Weeping Plum, one coat of the Mulberry, and then two coats of the dark flux, which is kind of just on the rim. Isn't that great? Isn't that great? So Weeping Plum, Mulberry, dark flux. Those three together. And this is the thing about dark flux. It changes depending on the glaze you use it over or under. And it went like a deep smoky purple. See if I can get it close enough. See how it's like a deep smoky purple? Right? The dark flux. And but the key is with dark flux is I think it works best on darker glazes. If you put it on light glazes, it's very contrasty. It's not always what you're looking for. So for me, my go-to is dark flux on darker glazes, light flux on lighter glazes. That's what I usually do. And so far it's working, I think. I don't know. All right. So we got a plate not made by me in the kiln, and I'll share it with you. So my cousin, who is the daughter of my aunt is only one of my aunts. I have more than one aunt. My aunt Sheila, the aunt I made the sink for. My aunt, you guys might have seen the sink when she built her new house. She asked me to make her a sink. I made her a sink. My aunt Sheila is only 4 years older than I am. Her daughter is only like 3 years older than my daughter. So her daughter and my daughter are similar aged, even though she's my aunt and her daughter's my cousin. You know, it's just how it works out. My grandmother had 9 babies and my dad was the eldest and my aunt Sheila was the youngest. So that's how it worked out. Like, I was born not long after her. Anyhow, my cousin Alyssa made this plate. I showed her how to make one using GR pottery forms. She'd never made a plate before. I was really excited to make it with her. And then she took my little color shaper tool, and while it was still wet, she did this really fun freehand pattern that she just drew in the surface. Isn't that cute? Just there it is. And then the glaze, simple lavender celadon from Amoco. How about that? First time making a plate. And she got creative with the feet. So her plate is done, and I'm excited because now I can give her her plate. But I love it when I get to work with somebody who's not made pottery before, and they do this. Like, okay, you're sitting there thinking, well, I'd do pottery, but I can't make anything. I've never done it before. Here you go. You can make this first time making a piece of pottery. You could leave with a plate. You could have your very own plate. And it's a nice deep one too, you know? Awesome, right? I'm excited for her. So this, I'll be getting to her soon. It's always good to have stuff in your kiln that's not just yours. So Charlie had a great question. Would the ombre transitions be better if you mix them? Yes, they would be. Also, we're talking about the mixing the ombre colors. So let's grab. So like the transition from the Weeping Plum to the Mulberry, if I'd mixed half and half Weeping Plum, half and half, you know, half Weeping Plum, half Mulberry, and then brushed a coat of that on as another transition, yes, it would be smoother. So you could potentially mix a 25-75, 50-50, and then 75-25, And then 100%, you know, we're going to do our percentages. You could do a smooth transition if you break it down like that, starting with one glaze, going to another glaze, and it would just seamlessly flow. Also, I have found when you're putting the next color on, do it before the first color is totally dry. Put it on right before it's dry because it seems to like flow in and melt a little more or blend a little more. Keith Herring on the plate. Yeah, the so I'll do like, you know, those are just like when you're doing a, so they're actually considered patterns that are taking a cue from the line before it. So they're more responsive patterning here. So this is called like a responsive line, responsive patterning, because you'll make one line and then you'll go in and do the next one, but you're responding with the line you're making to the previous line. And there's a whole bunch about it. There's a whole bunch of different art styles that deal with kind of patterns that will echo out from one pattern or just be more free-flowing and responsive like this one is. And I love it because it's intuitive, it's very impulsive, and no two are ever alike. So let me get in there. You can really see that patterning. But it's just, she did it just freehanding, and I loved it. It's great. All right, back to the pots. So I had to do a heart one using the Georgie's Interactive Pigment in Eggshell Wash, and that's what I put on the rim. I mean, in Autumn Foliage, and then Eggshell Wash on the entire thing. So Georgie's Interactive Pigment in Eggshell Wash on just the rim. I'm going to get it right the third time. Georgie's Interactive Pigment in Autumn Foliage. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Just on the rim, right? And then I wiped that back the Autumn Foliage and then eggshell wash on the entire thing. Now, Georgie's does state that their pigments are not considered food safe. I thinned it down. I wiped it back. Plus, it's only on the rim. And the way this plate is made, you can kind of see, no food is going to stick on that side. It's all going to flow down to the center. So it's fine. It's fine. The food safety issue with glazes. The problem is when you put foods on your pieces that might not be food safe, is that those foods etch the glaze or they cause the materials in the glaze to leach out. There's no foods going to ever do that. Those are tomatoey or lemony things, and they have to be liquidy, and they have to sit for a long time. So we're fine. You like to mix the celadons, Michelle. I do too. They're really, really fun. Diane loves my mittens. They were a Christmas present. I don't know where they came from. Kevin got these for me. They're called texting gloves. I've never worn them to text. Do wear them for unloading the kiln, though. Meandering lines start at one point and they don't cross. Exactly. Very meditative, very fun to do. So this came out really nice. And then the back eggshell wash, going a bit blue on the black underglaze. I think it's the zinc that's in it. Yeah, that's definitely what I think's happening with that. It's not a problem. Just is something to be aware of. Ah! Remember how I said there was more nutmeg glaze in here? Here it is. And this is on Tucker's Clay mid-smooth stone spec. So this is not a white clay body. This is a buff colored clay. And I don't think you can see. There are little specks in it. But let's look at the front. You see how warmer this is? Then the B-Mix, I'm going to grab the B-Mix plate. It's under a ton of things, so I got to move stuff. But I want to show you to compare. Okay. I want to show you to compare the color changes. And it's so different depending on what you use for a clay body. So these are the two together. I'm going to put them up close and tell me they're very close because See the clay body on the back? They're almost the same color, the base clay. There's just specks in this one. I don't know if I can show the folks on Insta. No specks, specks. No specks, specks. I don't know, can you tell the difference? This texture was made with a placemat, just a really great plastic vinyl placemat I picked up last fall and pressed into the clay. The pumpkin template, this pumpkin shape, I free drew it, but Clay Share members can download it. It's in the pumpkin plate class. So I just drew a pumpkin and then I used a circle form to make the plate. You need a pair of those fleece hand thingies. So Kev needs to tell everybody. But again, this was brushed on. I believe just one coat. But do you see how Instagram can really see? Look at that. I don't know if I can get you guys. I can't see the glare on my end's high. I'm trying to keep it from being high on your end. Does that look good? It looks so good to me. I'm really happy with it. Yay! It's a win. All right. But they're close to each other because the clay body is that mid-smooth stone speck from Tucker's, which is a light, light clay, and the B-mix, which is also a very light clay. So the clay bodies, the only difference is speckles. So if you're using B-mix with speckle, it would be similar to the pumpkin plate I showed. So if you were wondering what nutmeg looks like on B-mix with speckles, you basically now know. All right. Do you guys struggle with your copper glazes at cone 5? Do you? Does like your copper glaze not come out gorgeous at cone 5? I don't have that problem. This is cone 5. It's my black copper. I showed it already on, didn't I show it on something? I swear I had it. Oh, on the inside of a mug. But on the outside of this little pumpkin plate. When it's thinner, it goes blacker. So it breaks black. This was brushed on. Again, mixed up my dip and pour. 5 pounds of glaze. I mixed it all up. I shared the video. You guys saw me mixing the glaze. That exact glaze I mixed. I took my fan brush. I brushed it around the outside once. So there's... It's like a Temaku. Those of you who do reduction firing. So yummy. And then I brushed on the inside. One coat. If you feel that it's too thick for brushing, you can thin it down and do 2 coats brushed on. But I have used another copper glaze at cone 5 and it doesn't do this. And you know, it's funny because I made this, like I said, 20 years ago and I used to use it all the time. And I stopped using it because you know why? People didn't buy it. Nobody wanted my pot's glaze. Can you believe this? Nobody would buy this glaze. I would take plates and cups and bowls glazed with this glaze to shows. Nobody'd buy it. Not at all. Nobody wanted it. So I stopped making it because it wasn't selling on my pots. But I've always loved it. And I know you guys are going to. And you can get it at the end of the month from Clay Skates Pottery. So, yeah, that was a little ad, basically. Do the specks in clay cause problems with glazes? Not really. They just usually show through. Just keep in mind, speckled clays like to fire a little cooler than non-speckled clays. You could see the specks in there, and it looks like yummy eggnog with the nutmeg. I know. So those are the 2 new glazes. Yet. I only did tests with these. But anyhow, that copper, perfect, right? Came out perfect. How many more shelves? I know I have many. I have at least, goodness, 3 more to get down. I was like, this will be a quick kiln opening. Right. Heart goodies. Ooh, heart goodies. Okay. Another little black copper piece. This one I dipped. So let's grab the other plate because I really like to explain the difference. This one I brushed on, and you can see where it's thinner, we have a bit of black breaking through. This one I dipped, so it's a bit thicker. We don't have as much black breaking through. So if you really like the look with the black breaking through, and you can really see it on the back. Do you see the black? Yeah. You want it thinner if you want more of that black popping through. If you don't want black and you really want a nice solid all copper, reminiscent of a iron red or tomato red reduction glaze, you go a little thicker. So the copper glaze will work at cone 6. Yep. Yeah, absolutely. And it won't do much more than run a tiny bit more, but really not much because it doesn't really run. All right. Trying to see if I'm caught up on the... My black copper is a favorite of the new ones. Oh, you will love it, Linda. A little smoky Merlot. Smoky Merlot on this little heart plate. We did this, I think we glazed this in live this last week, didn't we? Yeah. So just a simple sweetheart plate. What weights do my new glazes come in? They sell them in the 5-pound increments for the dip and pour. They are coming out with brushables, but they'll be in a pint, I think. All right, here comes a lot of heart plates because it's Valentine's Day. We got to have the hearts, right? Oh! Look how sweet. Speedball black underglaze applied and wiped back to the love, to the words. And then I used the Laguna Peacock glaze, the number, the MS95, I think it is. And I brushed that on 2 good coats to the entire piece. Might have got a third coat in the center here just to make sure I got a good coverage. And then Mako light flux to the rim. That's what's going on the rim. Mako light flux. So hearts, you don't always have to have reds. You could do blues. Anybody want to know what size Jessica's kiln is? Well, this happens to be an L&L E23T with 3-inch brick, because 3-inch brick means it's more efficient and will cool slower, better for electricity too. And I love it. This has been a great kiln. It's about 7 cubic foot. My new kiln I'm getting is the I bought, it's just at Clayscapes, is an E28M, because the T means 3 rings tall, the M means 2 rings tall. I think it's the M. Maybe it's the S. Either way, it's two rings tall, but it's 28 inches wide. So it's for big platters and stuff, since I do all those wide pieces all the time. Oh, I'm so excited. Okay, this was holy cats. This is one of the peacock pieces we did. Not the last one. We have one more in the kiln. But this is the one we did with the pinks and purples. And I used grapple and wine about it for my dots. Those were the 2 colors. And then I used pink opal for my base color with light flux. If you like pinky colors, I like pinky colors, we would get along great. Here's the back. Oh, yeah. This turned out, I just want to get you in there to see how nice. Give the Instagram folks a chance to see it too. How great is this? How to get the dots around the bottom. This was the peacock technique that we did live together. So it's a class I taught. Also in the hand-built tray that we glaze together, we do the peacock technique as well. But this exact one we did together as a make-along this past week in primetime. So if you want to see exactly how this got glazed, you can see it. And the dots, I used a bottle. I used stroke and coat with a nozzle top, and we squeezed the dots out. It came out great, didn't it? All right. You do not like pink, but you love both of the pink plates. I used to not like pink. This is kind of a purpley pink. Pink has grown on me over the years. 10 years ago, I probably never would have done a pink glaze, ever. I think it depends on how it's executed, right? You love the blue plates. How did I get the dots on the inside of the plate? Oh, yeah, the dots. Thanks for clarifying. This was a little wooden cutout I got from the craft store that says love on it, and it has the little lacy edge, and I just pressed that into clay when it was a flat slab. Then I pulled it off and made my plate. So I used it like a stamp. I pressed that wooden cutout in. So those, you see those wooden cutouts all the time at the craft stores and the hobby stores? You can use those as a stamp to press into your clay. So, yeah. What do I use on the bottom to carve my name? So Ruth, I use speedball black underglaze and then diamond core tools. I use the L3, which is a diamond stylus tool. I actually have a free class on signing your name. So that, like, five ways to sign your name or something. It's also on my YouTube channel. And you can watch that and I show you exactly how I do it. So you might want to check that out. All right, we're getting there. A couple more shelves. And the cold's getting me. Can you tell? I'm shivering. But we'll go fast because there's big pieces coming. Let's see. Yeah, it's only 46 out here. A little chilly. My big shelf. Pull this one out. So I like these big shelves when I'm firing big plates so that they don't have to span two half shelves. You know, you really want them to go across one big piece. And I had some bigger plates. So this was a pink one that I don't love the pink that much. yeah, the other pink I like a lot. This pink. Meh. I think it's pink opal. And then around the edge, I believe I used weeping plum and then light flux. But we glazed this together, so I'll have to go back and check it out. The glaze kind of hides the pretty heart pattern that was in there. If you love pinks and purples, you might love this. I know, it's funny. I like pinks, but certain pinks apparently. Does my copper penny work well on texture? Jenny, honey, yeah. Did you see the pumpkin plate with the texture? So what do you guys think? Up there with the bologna plate. Yeah, you know, you get these pieces that it's kind of... You make them and they're not... it's not bad. And I know, here's the thing. It's all subjective. Like, everybody has different tastes. So someone's going to see this plate. Someone's going to see this. And they're going to fall in love with it. And they're going to buy it and they're going to treasure it. And that's okay. It's not my taste. But I don't always make pieces that are my taste. I like to experiment with others. Jenny, here's texture with the copper. So you can see how that works. The pink opal was a Mako. Yeah. And you love the pink plate. See? So Diane loves it. That's the thing. Everybody likes something different. And that's the beauty of making pottery. Because somebody can make something that they don't love. And someone else can come in and it's like their dream piece. It doesn't make it less valuable because the person who made it didn't love the glaze. I want to make things that other people can love. So to do that, I have to make things that I might not love. That makes sense, right? All right. Having a little fun with Chun. So this is Sand and Surf pigment from Georgie's. Applied and wiped back, and then my Chun Blue on top. That's Chun Blue by itself, kind of thinly applied to give you an idea, but texture is the 2021 sampler pattern. Pinks have grown on you in the past 10 years as well, but it's still a no to some pinks. Yeah. Yeah. Because it just depends, right? Everything depends. I can never say a flat, I love this or I hate that. I don't really hate much of anything. I usually hate making glazes, sieving glazes. I really hate pushing glaze through sieves. It takes a long time and it's just no fun. And you usually get it on you and make a mess. But it's kind of one of those things we got to do if we're going to make glaze, right? I think that's why brush-on glazes are so great that come pre-made. You're like, yes, I'm just going to use it. A little matcha gloss or oolong gloss. I made this last fall. Glazed it last fall. So it's an Amico Shino. It's oolong gloss, isn't it? Yeah, it is. It's good on texture, though. I like the greens and the browns together. Best pink celadon you've ever used is Kentucky Mudworks. They have one called Snapdragon. Oh, I don't know that glaze. I'm gonna have to look into it. Put some mother of pearl on that pink plate. Ah, yes, that would be great. My chun does go well over autumn foliage miracle. I found the chun goes good on everything because it's a translucent glaze. This one came out very sweet, though. So it's a pinkish one, but I really like it. This is Georgie's Rose Gold. So if you like kind of more pinks with a little hint of gold to it, you might like this. I like this. And this is, again, on Laguna Bee Mix. Nice, right? I really like how it did this. Do you see in the bigger areas where we have these striations? I'm not sure why it's doing that, but I really like it. There's nothing else on here, just two coats of rose gold. Now, this glaze did freeze, and I had to mix it back up. Maybe freezing it changed it and made it better. Maybe we need to just freeze all our glazes. No, don't do that. That's the cold getting to me and me being silly. Don't let your glazes freeze. But if they do, it's not the end of the world. Gold luster on the rim would be lovely. Gold luster is always lovely, right? Like, always. All right, don't let me fall in the kiln. If I do, someone come get me. Kiln post stuck to the shelf. Sugar. Oh, yeah. Hold on. Oh, my gosh. Look at that. Whew. Yep, I have to. So here's a little tip, everybody. Let me show you my shelf. They should not stick. They need to be kiln washed. This is a PSA to all of you potters out there. Please kiln wash your posts, because if not, they can sometimes fuse to your kiln shelves. And then when you're lifting your shelves out, they fall back off onto your pots below, breaking them. Luckily, it didn't land on a pot and the other two stayed stuck on, but they could have just as easily fallen. Both of them could have fallen off and broke the pots that were in the kiln. And then I would cry. No, I wouldn't cry. I just wouldn't be happy. That's something I would hate. Talk about things I hate. I would hate that to have happened. Okay, we're going straight to the cone pack and we got three more pots after that. So this is the bottom, cone pack on the bottom, cone pack on the top. Let's turn them around so they face the same direction so we can see how our kiln fired. So what we're looking for here is to see that they're evenly melted, the 4, the 5, and the 6. And I'd like to put them one in front of the other and look at them. And that's the best way to see they're the same. Yeah. So what does this tell me? It tells me that the kiln got to cone 5, definitely. It had enough heat work to get to cone 5, which means my cone 5 glazes will have melted, which we've been seeing. They all melted. They look good. And that the top and bottom fired nice and evenly, which is good for me to know, because if my top was too cool or my bottom was too cool, which happens and isn't the end of the world, it just means you need to learn what glazes like to be hotter and what likes to be cooler and put them where they need to go accordingly. That's all. So is it bad if your kiln fires unevenly? No, not at all. It just means you need to know what glazes like to be a little cooler or a little hotter. So you have an odd pink tray that you like that one. It's a great idea to put some mother of pearl on it. It helped it out. Okay. Was the fairy house? It was in the beginning, Tracy. Yes. You have to go back and watch the replay. Yeah. Diane, I'm glad you love those. I love them too. Okay. We'll go with this one. Oh my gosh, can I get in the kiln? It's so far down. Oh yeah, this one turned out. See, here's a pink one I really like. You never know. Chun plum in the center. Amoco chun plum in the center. We did two coats. And then we did snapdragon red celadon on the rim. And then we wiped back. Remember? We applied it and it went into the recessed areas. And then we wiped it back. And that left some of the red in there. And then we put a weeping plum on top of that. Yeah, that came out good. I'm happy with how that worked. Not sure what happened with the other plate. There's the back of this one. It looks like a can. It looks like a box of chocolates. It's about the same size as a box of chocolates. I wonder why that is. If it was a quiz, I'd be like, why is that? Because I made it from a box of chocolate. I used a chocolate box from Valentine's Day to trace out the shape to make this plate, which you can learn how to make one of them as well. And check out that heart plate class. Turned out nice. I like this one a lot. Very different than the one with the eggshell wash. You know, made the same way. I used the box of chocolates. I had to eat the chocolates first. That was the most difficult part. I had to eat all those chocolates just to get a template. Anyhow, same idea. This one we left the rim smooth. This one I ruffled the rim. This one I did more in a vintage look, you know, and then this one I did with the pinks and the reds. So totally different looks, made the same way, but a different take on it. All right, we'll put that up there. Another one of those oblong platters, and this one turned out spectacular. Rose gold. The Georgie's rose gold on this. I don't think the camera is doing it justice. If I can get in close, if it can focus on it. It's very subtle. It's really pretty. It's really, really pretty. I don't think it looks as pretty on camera as it is in real life, but it is. It's really pretty. So it's just two coats of Georgie's rose gold. That's it. The texture came from a rose placemat. You can see that texture in there. It's just made with the placemat pressed into wet clay. I used a cutter from De La Designs to get this scalloped rim. And then I draped it over a GR pottery form. And that's it. And then we put this funny, ruffly, bumpy bottom on it. Just a little good time. The center of that plate, Catherine, was Chun Plum. Amoco's Potter's Choice Chun Plum. All right, one more pot, then we're done. We've got it all. This one, oh, it's really sweet. It's really, really sweet. If you like yellows and blues together, you will like this one a lot. It's a very sweet, sweet little plate. It is for the dots. I believed we used the blues and Blue Isle. I have to go back and check the video, but I put dots on for my peacock dots and then light flux for my little W's. And then the yellow is frosted lemon. Look at the back. I love it. That's nice. It's a sweet little yellow plate. This is like, it needs a mug to go with it. It's a saucer for a mug, and I don't have any mugs for it, but this one would not work because the glaze doesn't match, although yellow and greens and blues go together. So that's another peacock piece we did together. You love the last tray, Angela. I do too, yeah. You just checked to see how cold it was here, and it's 10 degrees. Inside is only in the 30s. I'm standing in a building that's not heated. So it's only in the 30s in here. I'm cold, but c'est la vie. All right, what was my favorite piece? I got a couple, a lot. The rose gold is made by Georgie's. Sexy with pink opal and flux. Ooh la la. I haven't tried the rose gold with pink opal and the light flux, but I bet it's sexy as well. All right, so Georgie's rose gold, no more than 2 coats. Exactly, Marissa, because when you put more than 2 coats with the rose gold, it hides your texture. It does. It obscures it. Yeah. What do I think my favorite pieces were? Well, I mean, my favorite peacock piece, well, I can't say I love the cup, right? But I think I really am kind of over the moon for this plate right here. It's kind of everything. I'm going to go take it in the house. I'm taking this one. Like if I'm shopping, I'm taking this home with me today. I love that one. I love how the brushed on black copper turned out. Very happy with it. I had never brushed on my black copper before. I didn't know how it would be. It's fine. Looks great, right? So I can show the fairy house again. Yes. Yes, I can. So I would say that's my favorite. The nutmeg, everything. I mean, honestly, everything is great. Even the pink platter, that's not my favorite. And it's only because the pinks aren't exactly my favorite pinks. It's weird, right? Here's the fairy house. I wanted to go with a very warm, autumnal, woodsy fairy house. It's got some little mushrooms on the back and a sweet little bluebird. And look how warm and inviting it is in the house. A little happy heart window. And then on the lid, we got some little flowers back here and everything. So if your lids, when you put them on, sometimes just being in the kiln, they'll kind of suction on a little bit and you just tap, 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 and it will release. I usually a wooden spoon. I'll tap it. I'll take it in the house and I'll give it a tap, 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 and it'll be all good. All right, so there we have it. Today's kiln opening. I don't know, what did you guys like the best? I mean, everybody's gonna have different ones they like. I hope it gave you some good ideas for glazing. You know, whether you like pinks or metallic glazes, we had it all. All right, take care, everybody. Be well. I'm going to be doing some combos with the black copper and the nutmeg, trying them out with other glazes and see how they react. Don't know what they're going to do. I won't know until we test them. So I'll be doing a lot of smaller test pieces soon. But there we have it. Happy Valentine's, everybody. Take care. I'll see you later. See you Wednesday.